Okay, so I think some of you asked me about the room for the test. That's Torgerson, 10:30, I guess is the next door. So that's on Tuesday at 5:30, and we will have a connection to both Oak Ridge as well as Wake Forest. And if you cannot join us from there, then we will make some other arrangement. And of course, I will email the test to Oak Ridge and Wake Forest on Tuesday, maybe afternoon. I have the test ready. So at least that part of the game is over. Well, one reason is because my assistant, Norma Gwen, will not be working the week after Thanksgiving. So I had to get things done before she left. Okay, so the last evening, we were at this stage of the game. We had derived the Gorney equations for a thermoelastic material or a thermoelastic body, and thus in terms of displacements and temperatures. You do not need any other equation except initial conditions and boundary conditions, of course. So there is no need for compatibility conditions because we are formulating our problem in terms of displacements and temperatures. If you wish to solve the problem in terms of stresses, then you need compatibility conditions, because from stresses you will find strains, and there is no guarantee that those strains can be produced by a displacement field. So then you need compatibility conditions. But we are formulating our problem in terms of displacements and temperature, so we do not need any compatibility condition. So these are the four equations, as somebody from Wake Forest said last night. So these are four equations, and these are for four unknowns: temperature and the three components of displacement. So if we make the additional assumption, so this assumption is based on the fact that the stress is a linear function of strain E, and the temperature change and the temperature gradient change. So it's a linear function of E. The stress is a linear function of E, as you can see here, and it's a linear function of the change in temperature, theta minus theta zero. Heat flux is a linear function of the temperature gradient. So with those assumptions, we get these four equations. However, these four equations are not linear in temperature gradient or temperature theta and the displacement U. These are not linear in the displacement U or temperature theta. So there is no guarantee that you will get one solution of these equations. You may get more than one. There is no uniqueness theorem in nonlinear elasticity, which we have shown you that we should expect multiple solutions for some problems. So this is not a unique solution. So there may not be a unique solution. We also need initial conditions and the boundary conditions. Now, if you make an additional assumption, which is that U, I, comma, A, this is non-dimensional. So I can say this is much, much less than 1. By that I mean like it's 1% or 2%. Remember, this is length over length, so it's centimeter over centimeter. So it's a non-dimensional quantity. So it's much, much less than 1. By that I mean squares are negligible as compared to the quantity itself. Theta minus theta 0 over theta 0. So now it becomes non-dimensional, where theta 0 is the temperature of the body in the reference configuration. And typically it's room temperature. So if you don't change the temperature from the room temperature by more than, say, 1 or 2%, which is not a whole lot, because if your room temperature is about 300 Kelvin, so by that, by if you change it by 1 or 2%, we are talking about like 3 or 5 degrees change. And if you walk outside, there's a considerable change from here to there, so it's not 1 or 2%. So depending upon how much the temperature changes, if you can make this assumption that the temperature change is small, not only that, the temperature gradient, now this is not a non-dimensional quantity. So to make it non-dimensional, of course I can divide by temperature. And let me not put L here, so let me put say theta comma A. But still it's not non-dimensional. Temperature say in centigrade, this is in centigrade, but we are taking the temperature gradient, that means we need to multiply by some length parameter. So let's say some typical length in the problem, L, which could be length of the body, its width or its thickness, some typical length in the body. So this is less than, much less than 1. Then we can replace these four equations by the following: minus b theta 0 theta dot equals klm theta comma m comma l plus rho 0 r plus alpha hat lm theta 0 and elm dot. So the first, this equation, I think you can see, let me fold it. So what we are doing is, we are replacing in here theta by theta 0. We are replacing theta by theta 0, and here replacing theta by theta 0, replacing E dot, but big E dot by little E dot. Now this equation is linear in theta and displacement. And the next one, so we get rho 0 UI double dot equals C M L N P U N comma P comma L. Plus alpha hat M L theta minus theta 0 comma L plus rho 0 P L. So we have neglected the terms which are quadratic or cubic in displacement gradients. These are still four equations for four unknowns. The only difference is these are linear. These are linear in displacements and linear in temperature changes and temperature gradients. Now, with these equations, which are very commonly used, I mean, in most of the designs, these are the equations used. Okay. Most of the designs are based on linear elasticity, and that's what this one is. It's linear elasticity. It's not terribly bad, because in many cases, like if you are designing a composite, it fails around 2% strain. So you are neglecting 0.02 square as compared to 0.02. So roughly maybe 2-3% error. But you are compensating that by the factor of safety. Also, the values of material parameters like 21 elastic constants are not precisely known. So if you do experiments like Jessica or Josh or Pierce, you will see scatter in the data. So the scatter in the data is considerably more than 2%. Therefore, I mean, you can live with 2% error, and this theory is considerably simpler than the one based on these equations, which are nonlinear. However, if you want to design soft tissues or arteries or material for the arteries or for the heart or for the lung or your tires, do not rely on these linear equations. The error can be 100%. So it depends what you are designing, okay, what you are studying. If you are testing soft tissues and you want the experiment results to match with analytical results, this theory based on linear elasticity will not do the job, no matter how good values you have of the elastic constants, because strains involved in those problems are 100%, 200%. And if you have a 100 or 200% strain, you cannot say I'm ignoring it because it's only 2% error. The error will be 100% or 200%. So it depends upon the problem. So now we need boundary conditions and initial conditions. So wherever you see a dot, that's time derivative. Whenever you see a time derivative, you need the values at time t equal to 0. So we will need the value of theta at time 0 because there is a theta dot. One dot means you need one value. U dot, you have two, so you need ui at x time 0, and you need ui dot, which means velocity, at time 0. You need velocity and displacement time 0, which means you need to know the initial reference configuration and how the particles are moving in that reference configuration. That's the initial condition. Now the boundary conditions, we will need either temperature or heat flux, which is KLM theta comma M NL, N being the outward normal in the reference configuration, N being the outward unit normal in the reference configuration. So either you need temperature or you need heat flux. For mechanical problem, either you need displacement or you need the traction, which in this case is C A B C D U C comma D, and I purposely did not put M L N P because I am going to have N for my unit normal. So if I had N for unit normal and N as an index in MLNP, then you probably will shoot me. So that's why I'm changing it, okay, to ABCD. So this is NB, and that is the force per unit undeformed area in the reference configuration. So that completes the formulation of the problem. We have not solved it. Formulation means you give the differential equations, initial conditions, and the boundary conditions. Formulation does not mean you solve the problem. Okay? Now, for simple cases, we can solve these equations analytically, and if the shape of the body is complicated, which generally is the case, then we solve them numerically. And that's what keeps us employed. Because we cannot solve these problems for complicated shapes analytically. So you will be paid big bucks because you will be solving these, or you will be interpreting results of this solution of these problems. You may or may not be solving them, but if you are not solving them, then you will interpret results. So initially, most of you will get a job that will involve solving these equations for complicated shapes. Like if you are in the automobile industry, the chances are you will be working on crash problems or safety problems, which really means what happens if you are sitting in the car and there is an accident. How much damage is caused to the passengers, how much damage is caused to the driver and the vehicle. When vehicle is not that critical, that's $20,000 piece. However, if the passenger is injured, you are talking about millions of dollars then. It's your earning power from now till like, for the next 50 years. So how much you would have earned between now and next 50 years is the loss, and that's what GM or Ford or Chrysler has to pay you, or you pay somebody else. Yeah. So that's how they compute the damage. So far we did anisotropic bodies. Now I'm going to change gears and talk about isotropic bodies. Isotropic. So I'm changing gears now. We have derived the equations for an anisotropic thermoelastic body. We went to the linear case. So now we are done with that. And the next thing is, what if the body is isotropic? And that's like our skin is isotropic. I cannot say that this sheet of paper is made of an isotropic material. Generally speaking, steel, copper, aluminum are modeled as isotropic materials. So Katie is going to tell us, can we model teeth as an isotropic material or not? You don't know. Who will tell us? Who's in biomechanics here? Oh, Wake Forest people, all of you are in biomechanics, right? So can one model a tooth as an isotropic material?
Is bone model?
What about
bones?
Huh? Yeah, the answer is no. You are right. The answer is no. One cannot model a tooth as an isotropic material. And also, it's not a homogeneous material either. Most of our organs in the human body are optimized, and therefore they are not made of an isotropic material. Most of them. So what is an isotropic body now? Who will define for me? And remember, from your definition, we have to go to math. We have to translate whatever you say into mathematics. So what is an isotropic body?
A body that still continue to maintain the property in all directions.
Not quite. Sorry.
No problem.
In orthogonal direction?
No, you have to press that key and...
Property are same in orthogonal direction, perpendicular direction.
Not quite. Yes?
Is the material that the choice of the reference axis will not, it has the same property regardless of the choice of the axis?
Close, very close, yeah. So material that has same properties in all directions is called isotropic. The Pierce doesn't like it.
I just thought that's what everybody said.
That's what everybody said? Okay.
No, that's my English. No, macaroni English. I come from Italy.
I knew that part, but I didn't want to say it. Okay, he used the word orthogonal. So that's, I'm not saying orthogonal.
Okay.
Okay. I mean, she used some, she used reference axis. I'm not saying that part. And he said, even though he was on the right track, but he said it was his macaroni or Italian English. So anyway, no. So what it means is, that if I take this shape, this body, and I cut a specimen either this way, or I cut a specimen this way, or I cut a specimen this way, and do a tension test, I should get the same result, same stress strain curve. No, of course, in this lab, in our room, we cannot cut specimens here. So what can we do? If I want to cut a specimen marked in green, but my hexa can only move this way, what will I have to do? I rigidly rotate the body. So that's what we are going to do that. So I take this body and apply a deformation gradient F and temperature theta. So I get this deformation. So this is the reference configuration and that's the present configuration. Okay. Now, as one of you correctly said, I cannot cut this piece, so I rotate it. And let me rotate it by orthogonal matrix H. So H inverse equals H transpose. If you have a non-orthogonal rotation, that will be detected. But it's orthogonal rotations. It's a rigid body rotation. So I rotate it. And that's because my hexa is only, it can go in one direction. So I will get a different reference configuration. And now I have to do the same stress strain test. Right? See, otherwise I will, if I don't apply same strains, I should not get same stresses. So I apply same, I apply F and theta, so I get this configuration. So my stresses and heat flux in this configuration should match with the stresses and the heat flux in this configuration. If it is so, for every orthogonal matrix H, then the body is isotropic. No, Islam doesn't like it. Is it okay? When you guys told me I can cut this specimen in any direction. But since I'm unable to do that because of the limitation of my lab, I have to rotate the body. So the difference between material symmetry and material objectivity, we talked about material objectivity a week ago. There we were rotating the present configuration. Now we are rotating the reference configuration before we do any experiment. So the two are not same. In material objectivity, we rotated the present configuration and said, well, if you rotate the present configuration, free energy should not change. Now what we are saying is, before you do an experiment, you rotate the reference configuration and then do the experiment, you should get the same answer if the material is isotropic. Okay? So depending upon whether H is a full is any orthogonal matrix or some special orthogonal matrices, the symmetry of the material is different. Now, like for an iso for a sheet like this, for a sheet of paper, chances are that if you rotate this sheet about this vertical axis and then cut a specimen, you won't see any difference. But this sheet is not thick enough. However, the properties in thickness direction, if you can measure them, they are very likely to be different from the ones in the axial direction. So this material is not isotropic. And same thing about fiber-reinforced materials. Like if you take a fiber-reinforced material, and these are the fibers, and the rest of it you can say is a matrix. No, I cannot even rotate it through any angle. Because if I rotate it through any angle, I will not get the same material properties. Said differently, if I cut a specimen in this direction, and or I cut a specimen in this direction and do a tension test, for a fiber-reinforced material, I will get different answers, like different Young's modulus, or different stress-strain curve. So this material, this fiber-reinforced material, is not isotropic. However, if I have unidirectional fibers, then I should be able to rotate about an axis aligned with the fiber. Okay, I should be able to rotate about this axis and still not see any difference in the properties. So this is not all rotations, but some rotations. Okay, so it depends upon how many rotations are accommodated. And the number of elastic constants varies whether you can have any rotation you like or you can have some rotations that are permissible. Okay, take a single fiber, and if you want to see one, pull your hair. It doesn't hurt that much. And or not in your hair, not her hair. And you can see that the properties in the axis, along the axis of the hair, are different from the one in the transverse direction. You cannot see it, but you have to test it, of course. If you pull the hair in this direction, or if somehow you can test it in the lateral direction, properties will be different. But if you take the hair and rotate it about an axis, the properties don't change. So we have to figure out for which materials what rotations are permissible and about what axis they are permissible. Yes, Josh?
You have a material like concrete where in the same direction there's different properties. Is that still considered isotropic? Is tensile the same maybe in all directions? Or compressive, it's different?
That's saying properties in tension and compression are different. So that depends upon the loading direction. That's not, it has nothing to do with the material symmetry.
So would you call it isotropic?
If I could cut a specimen from a concrete block in any direction I liked and got the same stress strain curve whether in tension or in compression, I'm not saying in both. You take a specimen, you do it a tension test on every specimen you cut. And if the stress strain curve is same, then the material is isotropic. It does not say that the stress strain curve in tension has to be same as the stress strain curve in compression. I mean, if that were the case, then there will be basically only one stress strain curve. And by the same token, you can say the stress strain curve in torsion should be same as the stress strain curve in tension. Which doesn't make sense. No, that's a loading direction. That's a different thing. So this one is you are doing the same test. So the material that has the maximum symmetry is an isotropic material. And that's because you can have any rotation you like about any axis you like, and the material properties will not change. Water is a typical example. Oil, steel, copper. However, if you take a single crystal of gold, see, again it depends. If you take a single crystal of gold or iron, it's not isotropic. If you take gold, a gold wire, which is not, whose dimensions are not of the order of nanometers, but they are of the order of millimeters, then it's okay, it's isotropic. So sometimes it depends upon, even if I say gold, I'm not talking about gold at the nano level or atomic level. If we are talking about iron, we are not talking about iron at the atomic level. Because if you take a specimen of iron or gold of, like, say, 10 nanometers by 10 nanometers by 10 nanometers, it's not isotropic. But if you take a specimen of gold of the size of, say, 1 centimeter by 1 centimeter by 1 centimeter, or a millimeter by millimeter by millimeter, then it is isotropic. Josh brought out another point. Inhomogeneity is quite different, is totally different from isotropy. Inhomogeneity means the material, the body is made of more than one material. Different points of the body are made of different materials. All of those could be isotropic. There is no guarantee that the total response of the body will be isotropic, even if its constituents are isotropic. Because to get the, like in the case of concrete, you mix sand, cement, and gravel. The problem is the gravel, because there are the concrete, those stones. They are not of uniform size. They are not uniformly dispersed in the mixture. And therefore, the concrete is really an inhomogeneous material unless you test big chunks of it. And by big chunks, I don't mean miles and miles long. I mean like at least 10 centimeter by 10 centimeter by 10 centimeter. So there is a society called American Society of Testing Materials. They prescribe the standard of the specimen. They give you the dimensions of the specimen, the shape of the specimen, and how it should be loaded. So as a professional engineer, and I don't think any one of you will be doing that job, because that's mostly people who, well, those of you who are earning a master's degree, you might. So that stamp is valuable. When you sign, I sign as a certified professional engineer, this test is correct, you are putting your life on it. Yeah. So if you signed in error and the bridge fails, it's your problem. You signed on it that this test was, I certified that this test was done according to the ASTM standards and the results are correct. And if they were not, your signature is the one which will get you in trouble. And of course, it brought you dollars too. So it's the same thing. When the responsibility, I mean, you get money for signing that, and if you make a mistake, then you pay for it. Okay, now coming back to this isotropy business then. So this is the easiest one to study, and it has the fewest number of elastic constants. So let's translate this now. Our experiments, our stress strain curves are in terms of really free energy and heat flux. So let's just look at free energy for a time. So free energy is a function of F and theta. So if I do this test, test number one, I take the reference configuration and apply F to it. So I will get, I have an equation for my free energy. I plug in the value of deformation gradient and the temperature. I can compute a number. It's a scalar quantity. Now I do the test in blue color. So I first rotate the body and then I apply F. So what is my resultant deformation gradient? What is my total deformation gradient now from this shape, omega 0, FH? Very good. So at least one person is awake. So if I'm doing the blue test, then I need to plug in FH. That's what I did to omega 0. And I should get the free energy, same free energy if the body is isotropic. So if the body is isotropic, I should get the same free energy. And this should be true for every orthogonal matrix H. This should be true for every orthogonal matrix H. It's the same equation I have for free energy. In one case, I plug in F. In the other case, I plug in FH. And I should get the same answer. And that's the definition of isotropy for our case. Now it's math. You and I cannot disagree. I mean, it's the same. It's one equation. You plug it in or I plug it in. And if the answer is same, we are done. Okay. Now we know the polar decomposition theorem. Right? We know the polar decomposition theorem. And polar decomposition theorem says F equals VR. F equal to RU equal to VR. Polar decomposition theorem. R is rotation, V is stretch. It's left stretch tensor. Since this relation is good for all orthogonal matrices H, so I can choose H equal to R transpose. It's my choice, right? Remember, the material is isotropic. The properties do not change for any orthogonal matrix H. So I take H equal to R transpose. So here I have chosen, take R equal to H transpose. So what is R transpose? Identity. So I get phi F of theta should really be equal to phi V of theta. Which makes sense, which means that the free energy really should depend upon strain rather than the rotation. Any question about this? Now remember, we said principle of material objectivity must be satisfied. We have not checked that yet. We have not used that yet. So let's use it now. Principle of material objectivity must be satisfied, which means that if I take this configuration, either the one in blue or the red, and superimpose a rigid body rotation on it. I have this omega, now I rotate it by an orthogonal matrix O. If I rotate omega by an orthogonal matrix O, should the free energy change? KT says no. Right? So how many of you agree with her? And the rest of you don't have any opinion? I think we learned that principle of material objectivity says a rigid body rotation cannot change the free energy. So that's what we are doing. We are superimposing rigid body rotation, so it cannot change the free energy. So before I do that, let me do one more thing, but I'm going to use that. What is V in terms of B? What is V in terms of the left Cauchy-Green tensor B? Square root. It's B square root. And that really means it's a different function of B and theta. the square root is, I don't want to carry square root all over, so it's a function of b and theta. Now, if you superimpose this rigid body rotation, then b goes to O, b, O transpose. And the reason is the following. Because if we superimpose a rigid body rotation, we get xi star equal to oij xj, where O is the rotation. If you superimpose a rigid body rotation, then you get after the rotation is coordinate x star, before the rotation is x. So all we are doing is rotating it about an axis through an orthogonal matrix O. And the Francis doesn't like it. Is it okay? So f star is oij fjl. Differentiate both sides with respect to big X. And b star ik is fil fkl, which is oi j fjl ok m fm l. And that is O I J F J L F M L O K M. If you are using index notation, then you can write in any order you like, so long as you don't change the indices. And then this quantity is B J M. So B star is O, B, O transpose. So what it says is, now principle of material objectivity. Previously, this relation we got was from the fact that the material is isotropic. Now we are saying material is, we are saying that every material must follow or must obey the principle of objectivity. So this thing should also equal then phi hat of O B O transpose theta. So whether you, if you replace B by O B O transpose, you should not see any difference in the free energy. You should not see any difference in the free energy. Ganesh, does it make sense? You don't like it though. You seem to be confused.
I was confused, where did we get the stars from?
Oh, after I rotated it, after I put the superimposed rotation O, I'm calling that configuration as starred. So the one after you rotate it, whatever you get, I'm calling that as star. So otherwise, I cannot show you that B is transformed into OBO transpose. Now, so what it says is, no, whether you take B or you take OBO transpose, you should get the same answer. Whether I plug in B or I plug in OBO transpose, I should get the same free energy. And there is only one way I can get that. Okay. This is a theorem in mathematics which I am not going to prove. So that says that this phi then must be a function of first, second, and third invariants of B and theta. So it must be a function of first, second, and third invariants of B. And I think we talked about invariants. So first invariant of B is BII, which is a trace of B, like B11 plus B22 plus B33. Second invariant, if my memory is correct, is 1/2 BIJ BJI minus the first invariant squared. And I always forget whether it's, whether this is minus or that is minus, but I think this doesn't make any difference. This is correct. And third invariant is determinant of B. So my free energy is, instead of depending upon six components of B in an arbitrary way, it depends upon those six components through these invariants. And that is for an isotropic material. So the beauty of an isotropic material is because of the symmetry, because of the maximum symmetry in the material, remember that maximum symmetry is indicated by the fact that you can rotate this body through any angle, about any axis you like, before you do the experiment. Which really means that this O here is any arbitrary orthogonal matrix. Actually, this O is the from material objectivity, but this H was the any orthogonal matrix. If it were not any orthogonal matrix, we could not derive all this stuff we are doing. We will not get, if it were not all orthogonal matrices H, we would not have gotten the dependence upon B, and then we would not have gotten the dependence upon these three invariants. Okay, so what is then? Now I remembered my tilde, but last night I forgot. So this first Pavlikov's test tensor is rho zero, delta free energy differentiated with respect to the deformation gradient. That's what the entropy inequality gave us. So now this equals then rho zero, delta phi hat over delta F, so it's rho zero, delta phi hat over delta one, first invariant, differentiate first invariant with respect to F, plus delta phi hat over delta second invariant with respect to F, plus delta phi hat over third invariant, differentiate third invariant with respect to F, chain rule of calculus. No magic, right? It's chain rule of calculus. And there's an exercise in the book. I don't think I assigned it to you. I'm sure I did not assign, or I should have assigned, but I did not. That says you evaluate these. That exercise says what is the value of these invariants with respect to F. Okay? I did not assign that, so I realized that. However, if you allow me to use that result, and I assume you know it, it's in the interest of time, so I can, because we have 6 more periods. So I can do some problem in the, I still have not talked about fluid yet, so fluid guys will kill me. So I have to talk about fluids. Remember, continuum mechanics applies to solids as well as fluids. This thing we have been doing, there is fluid in here. Yeah, who will tell me? Okay. Who will tell me, how do I get? Well, maybe next you will see that there is fluid in this one, but it's a very special fluid. It's a non-viscous fluid. Remember, we are talking about elastic materials. Energy is stored. Obviously, we could not have any viscous effects. And if you have viscous effects, energy is not stored. It's dissipated. Some of it is dissipated. So I could not be talking about viscous fluid here. If it is a viscous fluid, things depend upon rates. So I have to have F dot somewhere. And I don't have F. We have not used F dot anywhere yet. So to keep my other half of the colleagues happy, in my department there are like 8 or 9 of us who works in fluid and 8 or 9 in solids and roughly 8 in dynamics. So I have to keep everybody happy. So we will talk about fluids. Okay, but before we do that, so what about the Cauchy stress tensor? The Cauchy stress tensor is related to Ti tilde. What way? How do we get it? What is the relationship between the two? So it's 1 over J F JL. Okay. Now if you substitute for this TIL from this term into this, what you will get is something like this. And I have simplified a lot. And I will quit in a second. If we of course, there's a lot of simplification. Yeah, I know not only Pierce is confused, others are confused too. So if you plug in this in here, you get this quantity where F0, F1, and F2 are functions of first invariant, second invariant, third invariant, and temperature. I will, by looking at least Pierce's face, he's confused, so I need to derive this equation. I will derive it next time. And I cannot do it in the next 3 minutes. We can go from this to that. There is no magic. It's just algebra. Okay, so enjoy your Thanksgiving break. And do not drink and drive. Oh, I don't have that problem.